So in the second chapter on the solar energy applications, we have discussed solar thermal collectors and their applications in depth, and many different applications where you first convert the solar energy into heat and then convert it into some other form or use it for some application. Those applications have been discussed. Now we talk about the solar photovoltaic energy conversion. This solar is remaining. And, what about this? I showed you this photograph, but whether I played this video, can you tell me whether a video on the solar central receiver type of power plant was shown? Yes, can you tell me whether you have seen this video? So if it is already shown, I will go to the next part.
The problem with renewable energy is the lack of continuous supply. Solar power only when it's sunny, wind power only when it's windy, and wave power when the sea's not too rough. I'm Russell Beard and I've come to South Spain to visit Gemma Solar, the first solar tower power station that can produce electricity 24 hours a day. But in order to get a real sense of the scale of this place, I need to get a little bit higher. Samuel,
my heart is in my mouth a little bit, but it's incredible, and I can't believe I'm flying this plane. Sam just spotted the tower up ahead, so he said just point at the tower and carry on. Okay, here's Gemma Solar. You can see it just below us now. Thousands of these heliostats, these revolving mirrors. It's just amazing. Feels like we're looking into the future.
Photovoltaic is like one of the fastest growing energy sources in the world at the moment, but these aren't photovoltaics, are they?
No, they're not photovoltaics at all.
So these
are just glass, are mirrors, and they are reflecting the light on top of the tower.
The reflected sunlight from the 2,650 heliostats combined can generate enough electricity to power 25,000 homes, but only if they're all pointing in exactly the right spot.
Santiago's brought along one of these miniature parabolic mirrors, which I guess is almost like a perfect scale model of your solar tower.
Yes, I mean, the tower looks like in the middle of a circle of heliostats, and every heliostat is like, taking a different angle to reflect the light on top of the tower and then to concentrate all the energy on a single spot.
So let me try.
It's going.
Oh, wow, you can see it catching fire. Almost. It's so sensitive, like one tiny degree out and it stops burning. I mean, this must be the challenge that you're facing.
Exactly. I mean, exactly what we have to be doing. I mean, we have to be very precise in moving the heliostats in the right position to concentrate the light there.
Sunlight is reflected from each heliostat onto a central receiver at the top of the tower. Sodium and potassium nitrate salts are pumped from the cold salts tank up to the receiver, where they absorb the concentrated solar thermal energy, reaching temperatures of up to 565 degrees. The heated salts are then pumped down to the hot salts tank, where they can be stored in a molten state or used to generate electricity via the heat engine.
This is the hot molten salt tank that contains the molten salts at 565 degrees.
This is like a big battery, but it's a thermal battery. It's not an electrical.
Here is enough to continue operating the turbine for 15 hours at full speed.
So this is what distinguishes this place from other solar tower generators around the world. It's actually that storage.
Exactly.
Being able to store energy this way means that solar power can, for the first time, be provided 24 hours a day, not just when the sun's shining.
This is the vessel in which the water becomes steam. Inside you have water at maybe 500 degrees centigrade and already 100 bars of pressure.
This is incredible. So what Santiago's telling us is, despite how futuristic this all looks, the actual business end where they create the electricity is much the same as any other coal-fired or even nuclear power plant. It's a steam-driven power plant.
And this looks like a power station.
And it is.
This technology has been around for hundreds of years.
Yes.
So it's really out there. It's the only sci-fi part of this building. By the time the power comes down from the molten source, we're talking about good old-fashioned steam turbines. And that's what we can hear now. And you can see it coming out of the little chimney at the top.
We are going to be reducing our costs, but also due to the fact that the oil prices are going up will make it impossible to burn gas to produce electricity. And then our plants will continue to be delivering cheap and clean energy to our children, let's say.
So I think this video has very nicely explained the central receiver type of power plant. Right, talked about different components, and then these heliostats also need to track the sun continuously to be able to focus the solar radiation onto the heat exchanger where the molten salt receives heat. And as it was shown in one of the previous schematics, right, the temperature could increase from 290 to 565. And there is a storage also available. He mentioned about 15-hour storage. And then that runs a conventional power plant. But of course, there is no fossil fuel, so no flue gases or rather the exhaust gases. So in a way, it's pollution free. Some questions on this, when this video is uploaded, you can write it on the YouTube channel or below that video in the comment section. Okay, now another possibility is to use a solar chimney power plant. So a very big chimney is installed, and there is a the area, there will be a solar collector which will have a very vast area, a few thousand square meters, right? And the height could be 5 to 6 meters, right? So the base or bottom would be the absorber, and then above that, at a height of 5 to 6 meters, there would be a transparent roof, right, which can be made up of some plastic material or glass, but glass would be fragile as well as weight and cost would be higher. So some other long-lasting plastic, stabilized, that can be used. Now, so the air below that transparent roof in the collector would get heated, and that air would, as it becomes lighter, it would move towards the chimney. Okay, now this chimney can be also a very giant chimney. The height can be up to 1,000 meters, so that's around 1 kilometer, and diameter can be around 100 meters, right? So because the flow rate of would be low, you need to have a higher area. So, and then there would be a turbine somewhat similar to a hydraulic turbine, right? Here also there is a fluid, but the fluid is air. So the fluid having much lower density. So per unit size or of the same size turbines, the hydroelectric plant can generate much, much higher power, while here air, which is having much lower density, would produce for the same size much lower power. So you need to have a very large size for the same capacity of the plant. And then, so it's a turbine, and that turbine would be coupled with a generator to produce electrical energy. Right, so this gives you the schematic of that. There is no need to put such messages during the class, I understand. Unfortunately, this has been told multiple times, but you are still posting the same question during the class, right? Why can't you put it on the WhatsApp? So this is the schematic of that type of plant, and this base here is a black surface or a absorber surface, and this is the transparent roof, and this is the transparent roof through which the solar radiation would pass through, and it will be absorbed by the bottom surface here. So the air in this whole area will get heated, and as it gets heated, becomes lighter and starts moving upward through this chimney. The chimney produces extra draft, so because of that the airflow rate could be higher, like higher the delta P, higher the flow rate of air. And then at this point you put a turbine. You can see this turbine here, and there are inlet guide vanes also to direct it at proper angle onto this turbine, so that the turbine efficiency is higher than the one without inlet guide vanes. And basically the kinetic energy of the air is being converted into mechanical energy, and then you couple a generator, it gets converted into electrical energy. Right? So this is the working principle and different components of a solar chimney power plant. So there might be a few installations over the world. Many of these technologies are still not commercialized, generally because of very high cost. So economical feasibility is generally the issue in many of these technologies. The advantages and limitations of a solar chimney power plant. Solar chimney power plant is suitable for vast desert areas where high solar radiation is available. The maintenance required will be very little, and technology is reliable as it uses commonly available materials. So the technology seems simple, and maintenance is also very low, and because the common material, steel and concrete, etc., are used, the technology is reliable. On the other hand, the capital cost, right, the initial cost of such plants is very high. And also, particularly this very big chimney, I think there are engineering challenges to build such a chimney. Okay. So chimney basically works as a column, and along this column you have the hot air flowing through, right, while outside you have the air which is having having higher density, right? And here you have a column, right, which produces an extra draft. This is something similar to let's say even a boiler, right, where you put up a chimney so that it produces an extra draft, right? So the pressure differential, which would drive more air into the solar collector. If you don't put a chimney, the air still can come out here, but the flow rate of air would be very, very low, right? So because of the chimney, the column that is created, which provides a draft for the fresh air to come in, and like more quantity would come into or would flow through the turbine to produce higher power for the same size. So basically it increases the flow rate. Right. Without that, the flow rate would be so low that you would hardly be able to produce much power. Okay. Conventional chimney principle is applicable here. Yeah. Now let's talk about the solar photovoltaic conversion. Now this technology is actually, if you go in detail, it's more of physics and electrical engineering. So different stages during the higher secondary as well as in engineering, I believe this is covered. So we'll focus mainly on the application rather than talking about or going in much detail about the physics and electrical engineering involved in this technology. So solar PV power is one of the fastest growing power source in world now. The total installed capacity in the world is around 627 gigawatt at the end of the year 2019. And this is around 3% of the total electrical power capacity in the world. And China is the first with 204 gigawatt capacity, while India is fifth with a capacity of around 49.2 gigawatt, which is 7.5% of its total installed capacity. Now some advantages and one of the advantages is that now the technology is coming down and it is now able to compete with the conventional power technologies. Energy from the sun is available free of cost. The only cost related with PV technology is its initial cost, and the maintenance cost is much lower than other conventional technologies or other technologies of power conversion or electrical power production. Then PV power systems need nominal maintenance and are highly reliable. It is a stationary system and does not produce noise. No pollutants are generated during the energy conversion. You can't say this about when the panels are produced, but where this plant is put up, something similar to an electrical vehicle, right? So when you run that vehicle, it doesn't produce pollution. You can have the argument that when it is manufactured, when the battery is manufactured, that is responsible for pollution, or it has does have some environmental impact. So similar argument holds true even for the solar PV technology, but where you have put up at that place, at least locally, it does not produce any pollution. It can be used as a decentralized small scale system as well as a large central power plant. So there is a variety of systems available. Certain challenges, though this is actually contradicting with the previous statement, but earlier it was more true that initial cost per watt of power is still high. Efficient PV cell is still efficiency, you can say, is moderate, right? It can't have efficiencies as high as the conversion from the heat to mechanical power or electrical power, right? It is still in the range of 15 to 17% at the max. Energy availability depends on geographical location, time of the day and year, and orientation of the panel. Right. Then for many applications, street lighting, energy storage is needed. So adds to the cost of the system. Okay. So this is true for all solar technologies that it is not on demand. And if there is a time difference between the demand and supply, you have to have a storage for that. Then the manufacturing of silicon cell needs high level of sophisticated technology and very costly equipments. Manufacturing of the cell also consumes large amount of energy. other PV technologies, thin film technology, are still not fully mature and gives lower efficiency. Then the principle of operation, I'll just explain it with the help of one diagram. And it's also described in like many videos available on the YouTube channel. You have two types of silicon material, P-type and N-type. The P-type is doped with trivalent material. N-type is doped with a pentavalent material like boron and phosphorus. So in N-type of material, you have extra electrons. In P-type material, you have extra holes. And then when they are joined at the junction, there is a migration of electrons into the P-type of material, migration of holes in the N-type material and electrons in the P-type of material. So that creates an electrical field. And this N-type material is micro-thin, and when the solar energy or radiation falls on it, the rays are able to travel up to this junction area, and that produces extra free electrons, which are attracted towards the N-type side of this field, and they finally are flowing to this contact made. And if external circuit is made and there is a load, then it will flow through that external circuit and then recombine here. Okay, so that's in brief about how it works, right? Then IV and PV characteristic of a solar cell, it has been described in this graph. So the solar cell would have some short circuit current, that is when there is no load, the current that would flow at a particular value of incoming radiation. And this is open circuit voltage, that is when the circuit is open, there is no flow of current. This is the voltage it can produce. And then when you operate it at some intermediate value of voltage, initially if you increase the voltage, the current is not much changing, but then beyond a certain point, this is called knee point, and it starts decreasing very fast. So power is nothing but current into voltage. So when either of these two is zero, the power produced would be equal to zero. And as you increase the voltage, as you can see, the power kind of increases linearly, and then it becomes a bit flat, and then again starts decreasing beyond certain point. So here at the knee point, the power is maximum, that's called maximum power point, MPP. And you would like to operate the solar cell at that value of voltage and current. There is an effect of the incoming radiation or irradiance on the power produced, as well as there is an effect of the temperature at which it is operated. So as you can see in these graphs, if the incoming solar radiation or incident solar radiation values are low, then at a given voltage you are able to produce lower current, and because of that, obviously the power produced would be lower. So obviously, like at 1000 watts per meter square irradiance falling on the solar cells, you would get the highest value of power. As you can see, like these points which are joined with this dashed lines, they are the maximum power point for different irradiance value. So maximum power increases with increasing irradiance, and maximum power voltage changes little with irradiance. Okay, so maximum power point for each curve, the voltage is not changing much, but the current is much higher, and because of that, the power available would be much higher. Now regarding temperature, here four graphs have been given, and the lower one that you see the highest one that you see here is for 10 degrees Celsius. Then the next one is the, if you move from right to left, the first one is for 10 degrees Celsius, the second one is for 25, then for 40, 55 and 70 degrees Celsius. So what you see, like we are generally interested in this maximum power point. So how it shifts? So at 10 degree, for what you can see at this point, the current is not very much different for all 5 points, but voltage is much higher when the temperature is lower, and that is responsible for higher power output at lower temperature of the solar cell. And that then that goes on decreasing, and for a particular solar cell or combination of solar cells which makes a panel, this is the result of some experiment, and you could see that at 10 degree the same panel which could produce around 54 watts is able to produce only 39 watts at 70 degrees Celsius temperature, right? 70 is a bit high, but then even at 55 it is 43, right? So there is a big difference between the significant difference between the power produced at different temperatures. So at higher temperatures the efficiency goes down. And then if you talk about a panel, then generally all cells are connected in series the way they are shown here. And so here 36 cells have been shown, and this might produce around 12 volts. Okay. And there is a, like many times, it's a good idea to get more details or understanding about a product by visiting a certain website or like a commercial, you can say, web page. So that is this one we can go through. So this product is available on Amazon. This is not just not to market any product, but because it gives you different, talks about different aspects and gives you some important information. I am showing it to you. Right, so this talks about a mono PERC 370 watt solar panel. Right, so this must be monochromatic silicon cell, must be using that technology, and this is for around 370 watts power production. Okay, 370 watt power production. So three of such panels may be installed to produce 1 kilowatt of power. And you can see different aspects of this technology have been described in this diagram. Right, so high quality anti-reflective glass reduces. So there is a glass at the top, but then the glass as it is described is high quality anti-reflective. So glass also has a reflectivity, but there are means to reduce that reflectivity, and that would ensure higher efficiency of a solar cell. Then the solar cell, as it is written, high performance grade A solar cells. Then drainage holes to protect against frost damage in the frame, and completely sealed junction box prevents corrosion. Reduced frame edges prevents moss and dirt buildup. So these are also important aspects from point of view of functioning. And silver anodized aluminium frame to withstand higher wind. Okay. So this talks about other important aspects of a panel also, in addition to the power that it produces. And then what is the size of single panel? And you can see like a standard panel of 72 cells, normally the dimension are this, around slightly less than 2000 mm, and the width is slightly less than 1 meter, 991 millimeter, and thickness is 35 millimeter, and the comparison with a 5.6 feet or 5 feet 6 inch person is also shown to give you idea about the size. And these panels, as it is shown, can be installed multiple as a rooftop unit. And then you will have additional components like inverter and meter, as well as like there are different options to if you go for a standalone system, you and if you are using only DC equipment, you can directly use it for different devices, or you convert it into AC and run AC equipment, or you charge a battery with that DC electrical power, or if it is a grid connected unit, then it can feed into the grid. Okay. So even some more technical details are available. Okay, this is particularly size, etc. And the product description is, this is almost all we just talked about with the help of those images. Okay. And then multiple of such panels are used to produce required powers. They may be connected in series or in parallel depending upon your inverter specifications, right? And there are different ways in which these panels can be used, as it was shown in one of those earlier images. Also, it may be used to, like, through a charge controller, you can charge the batteries for the DC power requirement, or you can have an inverter and connect AC loads through that, or it can feed into the electrical grid. Right. So multiple cells make a module or panel, and then multiple panels may be connected to produce required power. Okay. Now there are different possible categories or classification of solar photovoltaic systems. One is that you can use them as standalone system, so it's not connected with grid, off grid you can say. And other one is grid connected. In grid connected, it can be directly connected to a public grid, or it can be connected to public grid via house grid. Okay. Then the standalone system can be without storage, like a solar pumping system used in agricultural fields many times. So that may be without storage. So only when the sun is available during the day, you pump it, and it may be preferable to store it at somewhat higher height or higher potential, or in a, let's say, tank at some height, and then you can use it as required later on also. Then with storage, that will of course increase the cost of the batteries, and you can use it to run different appliances, okay, small applications, AC. If you use an inverter, AC standalone, it becomes AC standalone system, or it can be DC standalone system with storage. Hybrid systems, you combine it with other power sources, generally the renewable or alternative power sources like wind, because this system does not, you particularly when you don't have storage, it doesn't give you 24/7 power. So it may be a good idea to combine it whenever feasible with other sources of power. Okay. So it can even be with diesel generator or cogeneration engine. So these are different possible type of photovoltaic systems that one can have. Okay, so classification of photovoltaic systems, you can say. Right. So here just one application is highlighted, the system for street lighting. Right, so a panel and a charge controller, you charge a battery with the help of that, and then if your lights are AC, then you need an inverter. But if it is a DC LED, let's say, then inverter may not be needed. And this is showing the rooftop unit. So an inverter to convert it into AC and a meter, and then it is fed to the grid. And in a solar power plant, you will have a very large arrays of solar panels, and because you will feed it to an AC grid, there would be an inverter and transformer to step up the voltage, switch gear, etc., monitoring system, and then it will be fed to the grid. Though, like this single crystal, monocrystalline solar cells are one of the most common, which also gives you the highest efficiency in the range of 15% to 20%. There are other options also. Polycrystalline silicon may be used. Efficiency is a bit lower, 13% to 15%. Then cadmium telluride cells, efficiency 9% to 11%. Amorphous silicon, much lower efficiency. And then thin film solar cell technology is also being researched. There is generally some degradation of the solar cells with years, right? So the power produced will decrease over the years by the same system. Of course, the life of this system claimed is 20 to 25 years, but during that period, you can expect some reduction in the power produced. Right? So different applications, actually, this is well understood. I don't need to tell this in detail. Street lighting, solar lantern, running fan and lights, and irrigation pumps. And if it is on a larger scale for a building or for a community, and very large power plants of hundreds of megawatt capacity are now being set up, and they feed to electric grid. So this was in short about the solar photovoltaic technology. Now we come to the second chapter, or third chapter, you can say. The first one was about solar radiation and its availability. Second was solar energy applications. This one is on wind energy, the other alternative source of energy. Actually, out of the different alternative energy sources or renewable energy sources, wind energy perhaps was the first one which got commercialized on larger scale. And solar energy is actually picking up now only in last few years. It is picking up. But otherwise, this wind energy as a renewable commercial source of energy was the first one which penetrated much earlier in the market. You can talk about the history and the different types of windmill that were available many centuries before also. And some of those might be interesting. This is showing Dutch forearm windmill, which was generally used to. The name windmill comes from it was for the milling or grinding applications, but it was also used in these Scandinavian countries, that is northwestern Europe, for irrigation or draining the water out, because many of those areas are below the sea level. So the sea level or the sea water many times starts coming into the fields, and that needs to be drained. So there is a, just to make the things more interesting, I'm showing you a few videos. So there is a good video on this, showing the application of the Dutch forearm windmill. Design of a windmill. Of course, the commercial systems which are used nowadays are not the same, and they are generally used for electrical power production. We will be talking about that later. And you many times find those windmill shown in different movies also. This one is American multi-blade, right, which were normally found in American fields, and in many of those movies depicting cowboys, you will find this windmill.
Come on, Art! You won't win any medals up there, mate!
It's 2 hours back to Rainbow. We've got to get a wriggle on.
You got that? Yeah. I reckon I got it by now, Dad. Arthur, look after me, brothers. Keep my bloody head down.
Right, so this windmill that you see, nothing but the American multi-blade type of windmill. This was generally used for pumping applications. Pumping the water into farms. So this one shows it's a real good technical video which shows how pumping can be done with the help of American multi-blade system. So this type of this could be for people who are interested, could be a good final year project, or your other projects, if you are interested, can become a good project also. Yeah, of course, the commercial wind turbines are now very big in size, and they have a particular design that is three-bladed propeller type of design. But on a smaller scale, to cater to the need of a building or a very small community, these type of the other varieties can be tried. Like small scale applications. So this one explains a wind pumping mechanism, wind pump mechanism. I'll not show the full video, but if interested, you can watch it later.
A wind pump is a type of windmill which is used for pumping water. Hello viewers, this instructional video demonstrates the basic working mechanism of a multi-blade wind pump. Wind pumps are mainly comprised of 18 blades. The blades are slightly bent to an exact curvature. To efficiently capture the wind, a metal rib is fitted snugly to the blade and also has a tab that slots into the hole in the sail center, allowing the two sides to interlock. The metallic bands are fit through the ribs to assemble the sails together. The wheel arms that are screwed into the metallic hub hold the sails of the windmill.
Okay, and then that may be coupled with the reciprocating type of pump.
The wheel to return.
So if you're interested, you can watch the full video later on. So earlier applications of windmill were for different purposes, milling or grinding or water pumping, etc. But then the main focus became the electrical power generation. And different designs have been tried over decades for the power generation. And this one, the middle one, is a vertical axis wind turbine, the Darius type of turbine. But though it has been the Darius type of turbine is also having good efficiency, but still it has not gone to the commercial level at which the three-bladed propeller type of turbine has reached, and you don't find many such installations. Okay. So I think I had a video on the Darius type of turbine also. Maybe I'll show it in the next lecture. Was one of the installations of Darius type of turbine. Of course, in this photograph also you can see that, right? The middle one is Darius type of turbine, and the blades, you can see the special shape of the blades, and they are, if you cut it, the shape is an aerofoil shape, right? And it's coupled with the generator at the bottom here, and that can generate electrical power. So we'll talk about the classification of the wind turbine, etc., next class onwards.